Welcome back to Whitehead Presbyterian Church. My name's Ian Carton. It's great to meet together, great to have the reassurance that our Lord Jesus Christ is with us. Even though we're meeting in a digital world, Christ nonetheless is here present with us because we gather in his name. Well, what have you been getting up to this week? How are things looking around the house? I don't know about you, but I've certainly been finding that we're getting caught up with lots of those little jobs that we'd been putting off for ages and ages. We managed to get the patio done this week. We've already managed to tidy out the utility room. We've worked our way through the kitchen. I'm sure there are lots of things that we'll still get round to. But I suppose we're making the most of the opportunity to catch up on all those things around the house. I hope you are too. I hope you're managing to find things to enjoy, things to bring you, to make you smile, and to remind you that you are still alive, and there are plenty of good things happening. But this morning we are gathering to worship God. I'm delighted today that we're going to be led into our worship by a beautiful piece sung by Sophie Greer. This is "Tell Your Heart to Beat Again." Thank you, Sophie.
Fall away, Step into the light of grace. Yesterday's a closing door. You don't live there anymore. Say goodbye to where you've been and tell your heart to beat again. Tell your heart to beat again. Your heart to beat again. Beat again.
Thank you, Sophie. That's such an appropriate song to begin our service this morning. We've all got a number of weeks of lockdown behind us now, and I know whenever it started, for a lot of us, we really felt that life had come to a grinding halt. All of our plans were scuppered, all the things we were expecting to be doing. We suddenly knew we weren't going to be doing all the meetings that we might have been having, all the important dates in our diary, and they were just going to float by, and those things weren't going to happen. And it's wonderful to remember that actually God's plans have not been thrown into disarray. The plans that God has for us are still plans to do us good, still plans to prosper us. He's not planning to leave us alone, and he's promised that his light will still shine for us, and we as his people still have a calling, a place to be, and this is a time for God's people to shine. I came across these little verses in Psalm 130, and I thought I would share them with you as we begin to worship today. I wait for the Lord, my soul waits, and in his word I put my hope. My soul waits for the Lord, more than watchmen wait for the morning, more than watchmen wait for the morning. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, for with the Lord is unfailing love, and with him is full redemption. He himself will redeem Israel from all their sins. Amen. I love that. I love that image of the watchman waiting for the morning. It reminds me of being in primary school and watching the clock either coming up to break time or lunchtime, or most especially coming to the end of the day, whenever you were just longing for the clock to turn. And that's a bit like what we're going through at the moment. We're just longing for lockdown to be over, and nobody can really tell us when things are going to go back to normal. But no matter what, our God is still at work. So let's come together and worship him. Let's sing. Let's sing, Build Your Kingdom Here. Let's worship God together.
Increase in us.
Such a good hymn. Build your kingdom here. You might think to yourself that that all the opportunities for building kingdom have stopped, but actually they haven't stopped. They've just moved. They've just changed. God is still about the work of building his kingdom. Let's just spend a moment in prayer. Let's pray together. Loving God, Lord, we thank you so much that you are, even in the midst of all this trauma, even in the midst of our fears, you're still going about the business of sharing the good news, of sharing hope and life and light, of showing that you are the God who loves, that you will walk with us right through the middle of this darkness, these shadows. Lord, we praise you for that. Lord, we pray for all of those that we know and love. We think of those who are going through tough times at the moment, those who are going through treatment maybe for various things not even related to COVID-19. And we pray your hand and your blessing, your power for each and every one of them and for their families. We ask, Lord, that they would be very aware of your presence with them. And we pray, Lord, that they would be aware of our love and our concern. And Father, that if there's anything that we can do to show that care, that we will be able to do it. Lord, thank you for your sustaining mercy and your unending love and your profound grace. Father, we also pray, Lord, for those in our town here who are just afraid at the moment. So many things seem to feed our anxiety at times like this. And I pray, Lord, that you'll help people to see that there is nothing in all the world that can separate them from your love, and that you promise to never abandon, to never leave us. So, Lord, keep shining, keep reminding us of your summons, your call into the light. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I'm going to hand over now to Claire, and Claire's going to have a wee word just for the children. I don't mind if the rest of you watch, that's entirely fine. But this little bit is especially for the boys and girls. So Claire, thank you again for sharing with us.
Hello, boys and girls. Do you like to do mazes? I've got one here that I'm going to try, and I'm going to make it a little bit harder for myself by trying to do it in the dark. Let's see how it goes. Okay. Not very good. I couldn't see which way to go whenever the lights were off and it was dark. I'm trying to read my book, but it's very hard to see it in the dark. Can you read it? It would be much easier if the light was on. Oh yes, much better. Many things are difficult or dangerous in the dark. Imagine trying to chop carrots. You might cut yourself.
or putting on your clothes without seeing them. You might pick things that don't go together. You couldn't win at playing Connect Four, or you couldn't paint a picture without light. But we don't have to live in the dark. We have the sunshine at daytime and lots of lights in our house for the night time.
After church, could you do a light hunt? Find as many things in your house that light up as possible. Here's some that I found. The Bible says that we are to be like lights, shining bright in a dark world. That doesn't mean that we're supposed to glow like light bulbs, but it means that we are to be like Jesus. Jesus is the light of the world, and whenever we have him in our hearts and follow him in our lives, we have his light. When the Bible tells us we are to shine like lights, it means that we are to be like Jesus. We can think about what Jesus was like and try to copy him with kind and good words and actions. Jesus cared about people and he helped them. He spoke kindly to them. He was never selfish. Jesus often prayed. He read his Bible. He trusted God and obeyed him even when life was very difficult. Jesus shined hope into our world.
Here's a Bible verse that reminds us of this. It's from Psalm 27, verse 1. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? I'm going to make a frame for around the light switch in my bedroom to remind me of this important verse. First, I used my ruler to measure the size of the light switch. I drew this in the centre of my piece of paper and carefully cut around the square. Then I wrote out the verse and decorated it. I put blue tack on the back and stuck it onto my wall. You could make one of these for your room and decorate it however you want. Maybe you have stickers or ribbons. You could make your frame a different shape or from another colour of paper, or even from craft foam. Remember that we are to shine by being like Jesus. Bye.
Thank you, Claire. That's wonderful to hear. Thank you for speaking to the boys and girls with us today. And now we're all going to join together and sing a wonderful song. We're going to sing Shine. Shine from the inside out. Let's worship God together.
You love me.
Well, I hope you were all singing along. I hope you're all doing the actions. You were shining from the inside out and reminding us that even right now, that's really what we are called to do, to somehow find a way to shine. Even doing things like this, even having our service online. And it's been such good fun and such a good thing to do. Not just good fun, but good for us and good to hear from God's word and to know that we are sharing together. This is a one little way we have of shining and sharing. Maybe you haven't thought of this, but you can actually click and share this on Facebook, or you can share it from YouTube, share it with your friends. Tell anyone and everyone that they're very welcome to come and to join us for worship on a Sunday, or indeed whenever they like. It'll be wonderful to know that they're joining us and worshiping with us. Well, I'm delighted this morning. You probably know that this week coming up is Christian Aid Week, and because it's Christian Aid Week and it's happening at the moment, that's a real challenge for Christian Aid this year. And I want to ask Rosie to explain all about it and tell us exactly what that looks like and what we can maybe do this year. So over to Rosie.
This is Christian Aid Week. My first memory of Christian Aid Week is doing a house-to-house collection as a child with my mum, and it took her ages because she spent so long talking to people. Christian Aid Week this year will be very different. There will be no house-to-house collection, there will be no church and community fundraising events like big brekkies, coffee mornings or soup lunches. And yet, this is the year whenever we need more support than ever before, because coronavirus has spread to all the countries that we work in. This is the first time we're dealing with a situation where every single country that we work in is in this emergency situation. And people are not at risk just from the infection alone, but also from the repercussions of lockdown. So that means that if you don't work a day, you don't have food, and people are really struggling to feed their families. So what I would love you to do on Sunday the 17th of May is to have your own soup challenge in your own home with your own family. Have bread and soup, and perhaps you can send a photograph of your family gathering to the church Facebook page. And if you're linking up with other families in your household, then please send a photograph of the screen of your computer and show who else is involved. And you can donate online to at christianaid.ie/Christian-Aid-Week, or you can send a cheque to Christian Aid Ireland, Linden House, 96 Beech Hill Road, Belfast. Thank you so much for your support. It's a very different Christian Aid Week this year, but the spirit of joyously giving is still there. God bless.
Thank you, Rosie. Thank you for reminding us that even in the middle of lockdown, there are still so many people around the world who need our help, and they need the particular help of Christian Aid. And we do pray and hope that everyone will play their part, join in. Maybe you could plan to have your own soup lunch next week, and in that way we'll share together. And I hope that you'll all remember to give generously. It's one of the issues, actually, not just for Christian Aid, but also for church. I don't know if you've thought of this, but obviously one of the important parts of our worship on every Sunday is the offering. And it is an important part for you as a Christian, as a worshipper, to bring to God your offering. I realise that at the minute that might seem far away, but actually, speaking just as church, clearly most of our bills still need to be paid, and I do hope that you're either putting your money away in your envelopes, or you've maybe contacted Lex, our treasurer, or indeed you can contact me to ask about making payment directly through electronic banking. Or you can simply pay whenever we get back together again. But it will be really important that you continue to worship God that way as much as you can, as much as you normally do. And we thank you for your generosity and your kindness, and indeed for your worshipful heart. Now we're going to continue, and I'm going to ask Ronnie to read to us now from God's Word. Ronnie, thank you.
Our reading this morning is taken from the book of Isaiah, chapter 58, and commencing to read at verse 6 through to verse 12. This is the kind of fast day I'm after, to break the chains of injustice, get rid of exploitation in the workplace, free the oppressed, cancel debts. What I'm interested in seeing you do is sharing your food with the hungry, inviting the homeless poor into your homes, putting clothes on the shivering ill-clad, being available to your own families. Do this, and the lights will turn on, and your lives will turn around at once. Your righteousness will pave your way. The God of glory will secure your passage. Then when you pray, God will answer. You'll call out for help, and I'll say, "Here I am." If you get rid of unfair practices, quit blaming victims, quit gossiping about other people's sins, if you're generous with the hungry and start giving yourselves to the down and out, your lives will begin to glow in the darkness. Your shadowed lives will be bathed in sunlight. I will always show you where to go. I'll give you a full life in the emptiest of places. Firm muscles, strong bones. You'll be like a well-watered garden, a gurgling spring that never runs dry. You will use the old rubble of past lives to build anew, rebuild the foundations from out of your past. You'll be known as those who can fix anything, restore old ruins, rebuild and renovate, make the community livable again. Amen.
Well, thank you, Ronnie, for reading that that passage for us in Isaiah 58. I was really spoiled for choice whenever I was led to this theme of light, and I was also drawn to Isaiah 60. Actually, Isaiah 60 has a wonderful passage just at the very beginning, and I feel it's like a call to arms for the church, for us as God's people right now. Isaiah 60 begins like this: "Arise and shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. See, darkness covers the earth, thick darkness is over the people, but the Lord rises upon you, and his glory appears over you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn." Amen. Amen. This is a grim time in history, a grim time in all of our lifetimes. I certainly can remember nothing like it in my lifetime. But even as I think back to my parents' lifetime, and maybe, I suppose if I go back, the only thing close to it would really be one of the world wars. Because as we listen to the grim statistics every evening, and we hear about the numbers of people succumbing to this dreadful disease in our nation and around the world, it is like we are being pushed back, like we're being encouraged to batten down the hatches and to shut down and to hide. But actually, that's not what we as Christians are being called to do. Now, I'm not in any way calling us to not do the things that the government tells us to do. Please, please stay home, keep safe, do the social distancing that we have to do. That's only natural wisdom. That's just an important thing to do. But yet, we are somehow called to shine. We are somehow called to be lights in this world. Here in Whitehead, we have one of our local landmarks. I suppose the most significant of our local landmarks is the Blackhead Lighthouse. And a lighthouse is a great image of what we as Christians are called to be and how we are called to impact this world, particularly during a dark time like this. A lighthouse is a great symbol. A lighthouse can't actually steer a ship. All a lighthouse does, and does it wonderfully and importantly, is to shine. And in shining, it does two things. It sends out a warning. It says to ships, stay away from this place because there's danger here. There are rocks, and if you come over here, you'll founder, you'll run aground. But it also says another thing. It says steer over towards the harbour. Go over to where the water is deep. Go to where you'll be safe. In the same way, we who are Christians, we are also lighthouses like that. We are called to shine forth and to show what God is like, to show in the way we behave, in the way we live, in the things we say to people. That could be by over a telephone. It could be it could be online. It could be just a wave and an encouraging gesture towards someone that we meet. We're being encouraged, obviously, and importantly, to stay some distance away from people. But let's not take that to a ridiculous extreme, and have pretend that we have no responsibilities, that we have nothing that we are supposed to do. Because actually, I mean, alongside all of this, all the functional things and the things that we must do to stop the spread of the disease, it's been interesting to see the number of conspiracy theories that are developing at the moment. And you'll hear these on the news as well. There'll be people arguing over where it arose from. Was it cooked up in a lab, or did it just develop because of unclean health hygiene practices? What on earth happened? What's the cause? And people will speculate in all kinds of remarkable ways, and in some ways that's not particularly healthy. Even some Christians have been arguing that this is the end of days, and while I am convinced the end of days is coming, and I know we're closer to it now than we were when Christ died and Christ rose again, nonetheless there have been many occasions over these last 2,000 years that have been at least as awful and as bad as this moment. It's easy to get caught up in some of these conspiracy theories and to feel yourself drawn towards thinking dark thoughts. We will see end of times all around us. But the thing is, we are called not to be afraid. And sometimes we find ourselves telling people don't be afraid, and then on the other hand we're telling people there's a great conspiracy, there are people trying to rule the world, and this is part of what they're trying to do, and all sorts of things like that. But yet we are a people of light, and we're a people of truth. We're a people who have a calling to focus on the light giver, the bringer of light. In John's gospel, at the beginning of the gospel, in John chapter 5, or John chapter 1 and verse 5, it talks about he is the light of the world. And even though the world is in darkness and didn't recognize him, he came to be the light. So we too are called to be lights, to bring hope, to side with the love of Christ, to demonstrate that is who we are. And that has some implications for us. I was reading a great little book by a chap called Mark Stibbe. And he reminds us in the context of that during a great plague in the 17th century, there was a great outbreak of the bubonic plague, and Isaac Newton was sent home from Cambridge University as part of the strategy for dealing with this, and because it's not a new strategy, this self-isolating, it's been the strategy on several occasions over the centuries. And anyway, Newton was sent home, and funnily enough, during the year, by the time the plague ended, over a year later, he had come up with his theory of gravity, and he had come up with a number of other remarkable theories. So he had used the time productively. He had used it to do some wonderful things, and we still benefit from the things that he worked on. Now, we can't all obviously be Isaac Newton, but at the same time, he ended up calling that his year of wonders, his annus mirabilis. And so far from letting the crisis defeat him, he actually used it to energize him, to help him to be creative in terms of the work and the things that he was doing. Now we can choose, I suppose, to be inward looking. We can choose to simply focus on ourselves, or we can choose to be helpful, to be concerned, to be loving, to be gracious, to be merciful. We can choose to show the grace and love of God at this time. We can invest ourselves in learning more about God. We can invest ourselves in looking and seeing where God is in the midst of this. You're actually part of something wonderful that's happening. All of our churches are not being allowed to meet at the moment. And so we're all doing things like this. We're all putting services online, or doing making various efforts to make contact with people. The remarkable thing is it's opening up a whole new way of bringing the good news to people that maybe have closed off to it, who haven't been to church in ages, and maybe you're one of them. Maybe you're one of those people, and you've wondered, where is God in the midst of this, and you feel yourself a little overwhelmed by fear, and you feel vulnerable, and you feel like the darkness is threatening to overwhelm you. Well, let me tell you about the light. Let me tell you about the light that God has placed in us, because he has given us his light. He's given us something to push back the darkness. He's given us a reminder that God is a God of hope, And that hope involves hope for change, hope for restoration, hope for renewal, hope for forgiveness, hope for relationships that are that have been shattered, that have become mired in selfishness and greed, to be remade, to become fresh and new, to become life-giving. And it's wonderful to know that. And if you want to know more about that, I want to talk to you. I want to be able to say to you about how Jesus loves you. The Bible tells us he knew you from before you were born. He knew you and he loved you. And that doesn't mean he only knew the bits of you that you wanted to present to him. The bit, you know, the way you put yourself, you put your best on, a bit like the way we all used to put our Sunday best on when we came to church, as if God was looking at our suits and admiring our fashion choices. But actually, of course, the Bible tells us God sees our heart. So God knows those gnarly bits of us, the bits that frankly we really hope nobody ever gets to see. He knows those, and he still loves us because he has great ambition for us. He has great ambition for us to be the best us that we can possibly be. And he wants to protect us. He wants to protect us from harm. He wants to defend us. He wants to show us that there is a better way to live. So in the midst of all of this, all of these shadows and all of this darkness, let me encourage you to find that better way to live. And if you're already a Christian this morning, let me encourage you to live gloriously for him right now. Let me tell you about how God's desire for us is that we should shine. I love going to museums and art galleries whenever I'm on holiday. I really, really do. If you told me when I was a teenager that would be something I would love in later life, I would have been utterly shocked. But actually, I really, really do. And I don't know if you've ever been to any of these wonderful art galleries around the world, but they really are worth a visit. But it struck me, there are lots of stories over the years of things being stolen from art galleries, and there have been complaints about their security measures, and whether these products, these works of great art should actually be on display. But of course, art is made to be displayed. We could keep them all safe. We could lock them all up. We could hide them in high security vaults and lock them away. But what artist has ever dreamt of how wonderful would it be for my art to be locked away in a vault somewhere? No, art is meant to be seen. Art is meant to be noticed. It is meant to be viewed. We are God's workmanship, created to be like him, created to show him to the world. We're not meant to be locked away in a vault. We are meant to shine. So let me encourage you to put yourself on display. Find ways to share good news. Find ways to tell people that you love God, that Jesus loves you, that you are a forgiven person. Because Jesus says those that have been forgiven much will love much. So recognize how much you've been forgiven and let your light shine. I'm going to continue to worship God. I And we're going to do so right now as we bring our service to a close. And we're going to sing together, Light of the World. And we're going to praise God for bringing his light into our world and for helping us to shine. Fabulous words. Well, thank you again for joining us today. I hope and trust that you've been blessed, been encouraged, and that you've enjoyed spending this time in God's presence with us today. I hope to see you again next Sunday. And in the meantime, do take care, stay safe, and keep well. And may the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with each of you, those that you love. And we pray that you'll bless all those, Lord, that we have yet to meet. And we pray, Lord, that they too would know your presence, your encouragement, and your love, and that they would see that you only long to bless them. In Jesus' name.